Okay, thank you very much. Welcome to Temple University, Japan's Institute of Contemporary Asian Studies. I'm extremely happy to have Andrei with us. As you know, he served on the TUJ faculty. He has very extensive experience on campaigns and working in the White House, and also as a former CFR Hitachi Fellow. So you came to hear him, not me. So without further ado, we'll give Andrei the mic and control of the PowerPoint console. And then we'll have Andrei and I, we may have a short Q&A session, and then we'll open it up for discussion. So Andrei, thank you.
Great. Well, thank you for having me, and welcome to this totally insane process, which is how we select presidents in the United States. And I have worked on a number of campaigns, but only one presidential campaign, and that was Barack Obama's 2007 and 2008 campaign, first against Hillary Clinton and others, and then against John McCain for the presidency. So. I'm familiar with some of these issues from my work on the campaign and then also having having studied them. So, okay, so let's get started here. So just very basically, the presidential election in the U.S. is a two-step process. The first step is where we have the Republican candidates and the Democratic candidates competing for the nomination of their party. And this is often called the primary. Even though, as we'll learn later, it's a little bit more complicated than that. It's a combination of elections called primaries and caucuses. And this takes place, the campaigning begins earlier than this, but the actual elections in the states take place from February to June of this year. And that's followed by a national convention that each of the party holds in July 2016. So the winners, and sorry, there should be a two here, but the winners, so the one Republican and one Democrat, then face off in what's called the general election, and that determines the president. And that election happens on a single day in November. Okay, so just, this is a picture of the declared candidates back in September 2015. And as you can see here, we had, I think, 17 Republicans who were running, and so all of these folks were competing against each other to be the one Republican candidate. And we have three left, Ted Cruz, John Kasich, and Donald Trump. And on the Democrats, we had a much smaller group. There were five main candidates competing, and we have Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders left. So this field has been winnowed down from a fairly large group of more than 20 to five at the moment. Okay, so I'm gonna spend more time on the nomination process than on the general election for two reasons. One, it's much more complicated. Two, that's what's happening right now, so it's a little bit more timely. Okay, so what, so in this process where the Republicans are deciding their candidate and the Democrats are deciding their, who sets the rules? This is an important point that goes to some of the complication with this system. So on both sides, it's a combination of the national parties of the Democrat and Republican parties, the state parties, right? So in New York State, there's a New York State Republican Party and a New York State Democratic Party, and then also state law, okay? It's basically, for the most part, not covered by any federal laws, and it is definitely not covered in the Constitution, and that's because political parties did not exist when the U.S. was founded, so it was not addressed in the Constitution. The Republicans and Democrats use a similar process, but it is not exactly the same, and we'll learn more about that. And the way this works is both parties, they allot to each state a certain number of delegates to the party's national convention, okay? And the name of this game is you are trying to win more delegates to that national convention than your opponents. And for both the Democrats and Republicans, you have to win a majority, okay? You have to get more than 50%. It's not enough to have the most. So if you have 40% and two of your opponents have 30% and 30%, that is not good enough. You have to get a majority to become the nominee. And just this is just the Republican map to give you a sense of how they distribute their delegates. throughout the various states, right? So the states that are most populous get the most delegates, and there are some other factors that go into the exact number. But you see Florida with 99, Texas 155, California 172. And this is how they divide their 2,472 delegates amongst the states. Okay. Now, who are the delegates? Eventually, the delegates are actual human beings. This is a picture of the 2012 convention with Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan, as you can see up here. And all these folks down here, you can see these different state signs. These are all the delegates on the floor of the convention and throughout this arena. It's filled with these 2,472 delegates, okay? So that's eventually what this is building to, is these people at this convention, and it's at the convention that they officially nominate the candidate for president for their party. Okay, so who are these delegates? So most of the delegates in both parties are what are called pledge delegates, and they are determined by the elections that are happening in the states and in the caucuses that are happening in the states. So you go to vote in New York, and if Trump wins the most votes in New York State, then he's gonna get the most delegates from New York State. And we'll get into a little bit more detail about how they get distributed. But the basic point here is pledged delegates are based on the results of regular members of the public going to vote in these elections, okay? Then on the Democratic side, about 15%, it's 714 of their total. So the Democrats just decide to have more delegates than the Republicans in general. But about 15% of the Democratic group is what are called superdelegates, okay? That doesn't mean they can fly or that they can, they have special vision or something. What it means is that they are party leaders, elected officials who are Democrats, and they are free to support whoever they want. So the pledged delegates are pledged to a particular candidate based on the results of the election, but the superdelegates can support whoever they want. They can say today that they are supporting Hillary Clinton, and tomorrow they can change their mind and say they're supporting Bernie Sanders, and it's just at the convention where they have to officially cast their vote. The Republicans, they do have party leaders who serve as delegates, but according to their rules this year, they are bound to the results of the elections in their respective states. There are a small number of what are called unpledged delegates on the Republican side, and there are different reports and there's different ways to count this, and part of it depends on exactly how the results shake out in some states, but it's roughly, it's more than 100, less than 200 of their total are these unpledged delegates, and they also get to go to the convention and vote for whoever they want. Okay, so those are the two main breakdowns. For the Republicans, you need 1,237, that's the magic number, to win. So if you have the support of 1,237 delegates, you will become the nominee. And on the Democratic side, you need 2,383. So this is just restating some of this information just in more of a timeline fashion. You have most of the candidates who declared last year, and they had months of campaigning and debates and commercials, et cetera, before any voting happened. The voting started in February, and the first two states historically are Iowa and New Hampshire. So they have a special role in this process, even though they are relatively small states in terms of delegates. Because they are first, they are considered very important because they provide, on the positive side, they can provide momentum. If you do well, they can provide momentum with additional donations, more media coverage, more attention. On the negative side, it's the exact reverse of that. If you don't do well there, it's difficult to raise money, it's difficult to keep going. And in fact, a number of these candidates dropped out after doing poorly in New Hampshire and or Iowa, okay? So it's played a big winnowing role this year. Then you have the next two states, South Carolina, Nevada, Super Tuesday, which is a day where a number of states go, and then now we're in this zone of March to June where all the other states are voting. This leads to the convention in July, and we've covered this information already. Okay, so why do we have, we're gonna get into a little bit more detail on how they do the delegates, but it's a weird system, right? Why do we have this strange system? Why don't we just have a system where everyone goes and votes on one day, and it's based just on the vote of the people? So the short answer is it's an accident of history. When the country was founded, we did not have political parties. Soon after the country's founding, there was a split, and the first political parties do develop, and they realize that they need to be able to have a system for picking one candidate so that they're not dividing their vote among several of their members. So this begins with just the members of Congress from each party getting together in a meeting and deciding who their candidate's gonna be. Eventually in the 1800s, as the country grows and as the parties get larger, they move to a convention system where there are local meetings throughout the states, and that builds up to, you know, higher level meetings in the counties, and that builds up to state meetings. And eventually in all those meetings, they're deciding who the people are that are gonna go to a national convention to pick the leader for the party and the candidate for president. And so throughout this whole time, there is no significant role played by the public. This is completely driven by the party, by the leaders of the party. And even though in the early 1900s, you do start to see some of these primary elections, they are basically irrelevant and do not determine any candidates for president. 1968 is the year where this all shifts. So there is significant controversy at the Democratic Convention driven by anti-Vietnam War sentiments. You had Hubert Humphrey, who was Lyndon Johnson's vice president, who ends up being the nominee, having won zero primaries. He had won zero elections in the states, and yet he is still chosen as the nominee at the convention. And in the streets of Chicago, there are war protests and frustration at the fact that all these people who had voted for Kennedy and for Gene McCarthy felt like they were just being shut out of this process, and that it was undemocratic, and the violence breaks out with the police, and this gets tremendous national attention. And in short, after the convention, the Democrats, the party puts together a commission to look at this whole process. Commission makes a number of recommendations that get adopted. And basically, and then the Republicans follow that shortly thereafter. And from that point forward, the public plays the dominant role in determining who the delegates are, who then determines the candidate for president. But this is, until this time, totally dominated by the party. After this time, although the party still plays a role, the public is the dominant force in determining the nominees. Okay, so 68 is the key turning point. Okay, so what's tricky about this process is that the delegate election and selection process is different in every single state in America. It's different in all 50 states. And so I'm just gonna go through some of the important differences, beginning with the type of voting in elections. So I'm sure you all have heard of caucuses, but about 75% of the states hold what are called primaries. And this is what you think of as a typical election, right? You're a citizen who can vote, and you just go stand in line, and you go into a voting booth, and you vote. And the polls are open all day. It operates like a standard election in America typically operates. The caucuses are very different. It's about 25% of the states. This is often in the evening, sometime in the weekend in some states, where people get together at schools, churches, gyms, and this is a picture of an Iowa caucus from a few years ago. And you sort of gather in a group along with the candidate that you support, and people are sitting in different parts of the gym. And there's a process where neighbors can try to persuade each other, like, oh, why don't you come over to the Clinton table, or Sanders is better, come over to our table. And it's a whole process. This lasts, you know, a couple of hours often. So this is a much more of a commitment for the voter. All these people are showing up and setting aside a couple hours in their evening to participate in this caucus. And this is the Iowa one. What typically happens is, you know, something like 11,000 kind of local delegates who support the candidates get elected here. And you know whether they're supporting, you know, Clinton or Sanders. And then they go to a county convention, and then eventually a state convention. They get winnowed down to the small group that gets to go to the national convention. But this is what the caucus looks like. So very different from the kind of standard election that we hold in America. The other critical difference is how the states award their pledged delegates, right? So these elections we talked about, they determine how many delegates each of the candidate gets from the state. but how they get to that is very, very different. So on the Democratic side, the way the system works now is that every state uses a proportional allocation in which each candidate gets roughly, it's a little more complicated than this, but they get roughly the percentage of delegates reflective of the vote that they got in that state, right? So if you're Hillary Clinton and you get 30% of the vote in Alabama, then you get approximately 30% of the delegates that Alabama has available. Okay, so that's, and there's, I think in every state you have to get like a certain minimum of 15%, so that it's not really relevant this year because there's only two candidates. On the Republican side, it's much more complicated. You have some states that work like this, that are proportional, what I just described. Some states are winner take all, which means that whoever gets the most votes in the state gets all of that state's delegates. So Florida is a big example this year. They had 99 delegates and Trump won Florida and got all 99 of the delegates. Some states use a combination. They say, okay, if one candidate gets over 50%, they get all the delegates, but if nobody gets over 50%, then we're gonna do proportional. Or they say, or they divide up the state into the districts and they say, if you win this district, you get all the delegates for this district, but somebody else can get all the delegates from another district. So there's various hybrid and combination forms of these two things. And then there are a few states on the Republican side that are not even holding a real election, and they just have a party convention that is sending a handful of unpledged, unbound delegates to the convention. Okay, so there are a few states that where the party leaders are very much controlling who the delegates are that are gonna get to go to the convention. Some other differences, some states look at the statewide vote, some states look at congressional districts, which is just part of the state, and some use a combination of those two. There's also, and this is getting much more attention now in the media just in the last week or two and will continue to get attention, states have very different processes for selecting the actual people who serve as the delegates, okay? So, I'll get back to that a little bit later, but even though you know, okay, that 30% of the delegates for the state are gonna have to vote for Trump at the convention, figuring out who those actual people are varies quite a bit state to state. And then states also have different rules about whether independent voters can participate. So in America, it's very easy to register as a Republican or a Democrat. Usually when you go get your license, you can just check a box, and there's no requirements to give money to the party. There's no requirement of other participation. It's just a box you get to check that the government has a record of, and that means you can, you know, participate in the primary on the Republican or Democratic side. And for the about 40% of Americans who are independent, states have different rules about whether they can participate in the primaries or not. Okay, so here's a quick example, Florida. So Florida has 27 congressional districts. So these are in the House of Representatives in the US, which is the lower house. These are the areas that each of the 27 members from Florida represent. And on the Republican side, as I mentioned, it was winner take all. So Trump, he didn't even get 50%. He got 45.7% of the vote, but that was more than anybody else. And so he got all 99 delegates in Florida. On the Democratic side, it was proportional. So there were a certain number of delegates in each of these districts. And so how the vote turned out in each district determines how many delegates Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders got. And then they also looked at the full statewide vote and awarded some proportionally based on that. And so the way it shook out this year was that Clinton got about 64% and she got 141 delegates and Sanders got about 73. But you can see here, you know, she had a much higher vote total than Trump, but the gap in delegates is quite a bit smaller than what Trump got through his winner-take-all system. So this matters quite a bit, whether it's winner-take-all or proportional. Okay, so this is where we stand today. And this incorporates, Wisconsin just held their election yesterday. And this incorporates the results that we had as of midnight US time, which was most of the Wisconsin results, but not all of them. And so you see Trump has a significant lead over Ted Cruz, but he still needs 497 delegates to get to the magic number of 1237. And with Clinton, I want you to look at this number first, which is 1274, against 1,025. That's about 250 lead. That's the number of pledged delegates. So those are the ones determined by the elections in the states. When you include the superdelegates, so these are the elected leaders that can support whoever they want, Clinton's margin gets quite larger. You add that together, it's 1,743 or 1,056. But you'll see both in different media reports, you'll see them using different numbers because superdelegates, as I mentioned, they can change their vote. And this happened in 2008. Clinton had a majority of the superdelegates, but as Obama did better and better, and as it appeared that he was gonna secure a majority of pledged delegates, a number of the superdelegates began to switch their votes from Clinton to Obama. So you can kind of look at either of these numbers, but I think it's better for now just to look at this 1,274 against 1,025. This is just a map of the Republican results to date. And I thought it was just helpful to see, it shows you which states haven't voted yet in gray, but also just helpful to see what a big difference it makes whether a state is winner take all or proportional, right? So if you take Iowa, for example, which was a very big deal because it was the first state and Ted Cruz won, and he got a huge amount of attention because of that win. But in terms of actual delegates, he got 8, Trump got 7, and Marco Rubio got 7. Okay, so he had one delegate lead over the two of them coming out of Iowa, which is obviously very, very, very small as can be. But then you look down here at Florida, Trump, 99 from winning Florida, which of course is a bigger state, but also the winner-take-all nature allowed him to accumulate a bunch. You have Texas was a big one for Cruz because that's where he's from. But you see these huge numbers in these winner-take-all states. And there are more of these coming up because under the Republican rules, you could only begin the winner-take-all state in mid-March. And so all the early states had to be proportional. Okay, so just keep that in mind. So the big question right on the Democratic side is, can Bernie Sanders catch up to Hillary Clinton? He's actually won the vast majority of recent caucuses and primaries. He had a good win in Wisconsin yesterday, but he still trails by somewhere between 225 and 250 delegates, depending on which media source you trust. And the margin, that's not even including the superdelegates. So the margin is even greater with the superdelegates. And because the Democrats use a proportional system in every state, it is gonna be very, very difficult for him to catch up in this number. He has to win a number of states by very, very large margins and would have to outperform current polling in a number of those states. So I think it's very unlikely that he will be able to catch up to Hillary Clinton, just based on the math of where we are right now. Okay, so will Trump be the Republican nominee, right? This is the big question in American politics today. And part of that question is, can he get to 1,237 delegates, right? That's the magic number. That's the majority that he needs. And he got crushed in Wisconsin by Ted Cruz in America yesterday, or earlier this morning, if you're doing Japan time. So Cruz, there are 42 delegates in Wisconsin, and I show you the rules here, but we're still waiting on a few of the results, but so far Cruz had won 33 of the delegates, and Trump had won just 3, and there were only 6 more remaining. So even if Trump wins the remaining 6, it's still a huge victory for Cruz in Wisconsin. And this result has made it that much more difficult for Trump to get to 1,237. So he now needs to win about 65 to 70% of the remaining delegates available to become the nominee. If you include the unpledged delegates, remember there are about 100 to 200 unpledged delegates at the moment, and that number will probably go a bit higher because of Rubio's delegates eventually. But if you include those, he needs about 55% of them. But most people think that he's not gonna get very many of those unpledged delegates because most of the Republican Party establishment hates Trump, and most of those unpledged folks are part of the establishment. So the more relevant number kind of going into the convention is whether he can get 65 to 70%. And that will be difficult. It's possible because some of these upcoming states include New York, and include some other winner-take-all states, but it'll be very difficult. Right now, he's been capturing about somewhere in the high 40s in terms of number of delegates, okay? So he's gonna have to capture a much higher percentage to secure the nomination. So these are just some of the key upcoming states. We had Wisconsin, which I showed you. New York is a big one for Trump. 95 delegates there with varying winner-take-all rules. Indiana is another big one that has winner-take-all to the statewide winner and then a few to each of the congressional districts. And then I think most observers think we won't know the answer to this question until at least June 7th. There's California and a few other states. California has 172 delegates, which is a huge number. And so I don't think we're likely to know the answer to this question until at least June 7th, okay? So let's say Trump does not get to 1,237, okay? Let's say he doesn't get there. And I should say, he's the only one that has a chance of getting there, okay? Kasich is mathematically, it's mathematically impossible for Kasich to get there. And Cruz would have to win something like 90 or 95% of the delegates to get there, maybe 90%. So the only question kind of right now is Trump gonna get there or is nobody gonna get there? So what happens if Trump gets less than 1,237 after the last elections are held on June 7th? Okay, there are two main possibilities. One is that he's very close, and he's able to convince enough of these unpledged delegates that put him over 1,237. So under this scenario, he's just a little bit short after the June 7th elections, and he gets just enough of these guys and gals to put him over to 1,237, okay? If that doesn't happen, we are likely to have what's called a contested or open Republican convention, sometimes called a brokered convention is another word for it. There are perhaps slight distinctions between these terms, but I think they're basically interchangeable. And there's different, people kind of have different definitions of this. What I'm gonna use is I'm gonna consider it contested if nobody gets 1,237 on the first ballot, okay? So there have been, since 1968, I think three occasions where a candidate was going in without having hit the magic number, but in all three, they secured enough extra support to get there so that there was, on the first ballot, they became the nominee. We have not had a second ballot, I think, since the 1950s. So this has been a long time since we have faced something that might happen here. Okay, so what would happen here? So state rules vary, but most delegates only have to vote for their designated candidate on the first or second ballot. After the first ballot, more than 50% are free to vote for whoever they want, and after the second ballot, more than 80% are free to vote for whoever they want. Okay, so you do a vote, all the Cruz people vote for Cruz, the Trump people vote for Trump, the Rubio people vote for Rubio, the Kasich people root for Kasich, and nobody has 1,237. Okay, then you go to a second ballot, but now a number of the delegates can vote for whoever they want. And you keep doing ballots until someone gets to 1,237, okay? So there's examples, if you go far enough back in history, of more than 100 ballots, okay? So this can last a long time, potentially. So what's happening now in a bunch of states is they're going through the process of figuring out who these actual human beings are gonna be that serve as delegates. And this varies widely in the state. So in some states, the candidate gets to pick who their delegates are after the fact. So, you know, Trump gets 30 delegates in state X, and he gets to then submit a list of the people that he wants to serve as delegate from that state. Okay, so in those states, the candidates have a lot of control over who the human beings are that are gonna serve as delegates. But in most Republican states, there's a different process. And in many of them, it's a process that's controlled by the state party through a series of meetings or conventions, or the executive committee of the state party just decides. And in those situations, you could have, let's say, again, there's 30 delegates that are supporting Trump, but some of those people potentially might not actually be Trump supporters. So those people would have to vote for Trump on the first or second ballot, first and or second ballot, but then after that, they're kind of free to vote for whoever they want. So who these human beings end up being is very important. And what news reports have suggested is that the Cruz campaign has been much more organized and diligent about making sure that as many of those delegates as possible are supporters of Cruz and not necessarily Trump supporters. So this is like a real thing that's playing out in the states. A number of states are going through this process this month and next month. So I think this will get a lot more media attention in the coming weeks, to the extent that you are paying attention to that. The other reason who these actual human beings are is important is that one of the first things that happens at the convention is they vote on the rules of the convention. And they can change the rules, and they can change it in a way that's harmful to Trump, or even potentially harmful to Trump and Cruz. Okay, so they, in theory, they could change the threshold for getting the nomination. They could try to change the rule about you having to vote for the candidate on the first ballot. That might free up some of the delegates who are not bound by state law to do that. And the rule that's getting the most attention right now is there's a rule that says that to even qualify to be the nominee, you have to have won 8 states, or the majority of delegates in 8 states. And Cruz and Trump are likely the only two that are going to be able to meet that threshold. So there's a lot of discussion now about that they might try to change that rule, which would allow anybody to become the nominee if nobody gets it on the first or second ballot, right? So that's where there's this discussion of maybe Paul Ryan, who's the Speaker of the House, that he could potentially end up being the nominee, or Mitt Romney, or other people, okay? Or John Kasich. But that's basically how this could play out. I think the important point here is legally, they can do virtually anything they want in terms of the rules change. But obviously there's a potentially like a huge political cost, right? If they do some things that is perceived as taking the nomination away from Trump or stealing it from him, you know, Trump has already said things about how there's gonna be riots at the convention if that's what happens. It could, splinter the Republican Party. You could end up with, Trump trying to latch on to one of these smaller parties and running as sort of a third party candidate for the presidency. So there's a lot of risk involved with doing that, but these conversations are happening, in the Republican Party and are being theorized about by the press. So let me just quickly, we're doing on time here. Let me just quickly cover the general election, which also not completely simple, but is a little easier to explain. So we have the Electoral College, which is a compromise that emerges from the Constitutional Convention. Each state gets a certain number of electors. It is basically based on population, though here is the exact math of how we get the numbers. And with a couple of exceptions, in every state, whoever wins the state, it's winner take all. They get all of the electoral votes from that state. And to become president, again, you need a majority of the Electoral College votes. A plurality is not enough. So if you have 3 candidates or there's a tie, you do not become president. So here are the results from the 2012 election between Obama and Romney. And here you see there's a total of 538. You need 270 to win. And this is how it's, the red states are the ones that Romney won, the blue states were won by Obama, and these numbers are the Electoral College numbers. So you see the actual vote was relatively close. We have Obama with 50.6% and Romney with 47.8%. So in terms of percentages, relatively close. But you see here that the way it broke out with the states, Obama won by a very significant margin with 332 to Romney's 206. And this just covers whether you can win the popular vote but lose the Electoral College. Yes, that's happened 4 times in American history, most recently Al Gore in 2000. And if no one gets a majority or there's a tie, it then gets kicked to the House of Representatives, which is the lower house in the American Congress. And each state delegation in the House of Representatives gets 1 vote. So New York would get 1 vote collectively, and Wyoming would get 1 vote, and that would determine the president. Here's just a preview map of the 2016 election, and there are different versions of this, but this is, most of them are roughly the same. So the dark red are states that are almost certainly gonna vote Republican, the dark blue states are almost certain to vote Democratic, and then you have the lighter colors are the ones that are leaning one way or another, and then these yellow states are what we call the battleground states, or the swing states, or the purple states. There are a number of different phrases for it and words for it. But these are the states where the presidential campaign is waged between the Republicans and Democrats, because it's these yellow states that will determine the presidency most likely. We can talk a little bit about whether Trump might change some of these states or what would happen in a Clinton Trump or Clinton Cruz campaign. But this is sort of a preview map and shows you the states where the most serious contests will happen. And why don't we just leave it there? I'll save that last slide for the questions.
Can we turn this mic on? It's on. Okay, thanks. Thank you very much, Andre. It was a brilliant tour d'horizon of a very, very complex system. We have about an hour left, so I think we'll start immediately with questions from the floor. So the procedure is that you should raise your hand, or two hands, or three hands, and then you'll go up here, we'll select you, and you'll go up to speak into the mic, so that's recorded for posterity. If for some reason you don't want to be recorded, you can stay where you are, you know, put a hood over your face, and you will remain incognito. So if you have any questions, raise your hand. Okay, but Miguel-san, so you go to the podium.
You said the convention can change the rule, but who can change the rule? You said the convention, but who governs the convention?
Thank you for that question. That's a good question. So the short answer is that all of the delegates who are attending the convention can change the rules of the convention. So there's at each convention on both the Democratic and Republican side, there's a committee that's called the Rules Committee. And that is made up of delegates who have been elected to the convention. And so they can issue a recommended report, but there's also mechanisms for a minority group to issue a report out of that committee. And then the full convention votes on whether to approve those recommendations or not. So you would have, just to go back here, there would be a rules committee that would meet on the Republican side. It's made up of just over 100 people. I think it's two delegates from each state plus some other people. So they would come up with this report or recommendation, and then all of these delegates would get to vote on it. And if a majority voted in favor, then the rules would pass. Is that clear? But it's a strange system, because everyone's operating according to these rules, but many of them are technically sort of draft rules until they're fully approved by the convention at the convention in July. So they can't do absolutely anything they want, because there are state laws and other things that govern the process, but they can basically, anything that's not contradicting state law, they can basically change if they want to. But you haven't seen that much of that in recent history, because although it may be legally and procedurally possible, it is, you know, difficult to do practically and politically.
Hi. So how does someone become a superdelegate, or even a delegate in general? How do you actually find like a career path in working in a party or something like that?
You're interested in becoming a professional delegate?
No, not necessarily.
No, okay.
I'm just curious.
All right. Well, the short answer is there is this group of people who automatically become delegates, who are elected officials or leaders in either the national party or the state party. So like three of the delegates from each of the Republican states are automatic delegates from the from the state party of that state. But otherwise, this process varies a lot state to state, but you know, basically you can, as a regular citizen, you know, get involved with your party and then try to become a delegate. And there's usually a process of having people vote for who those delegates are gonna be. So it's a tough question to answer because it does vary. Like in some states, you have to kind of be a more active member of the state party. Other states, it's completely open to just anybody who is a registered member of the party and who is just interested in being a delegate. You know, when I was working on the Obama campaign, at the beginning of the campaign, I was working in New York and New Jersey, and those states are, as I later learned, a little bit unusual in that the delegates are actually on the ballot with the candidates, and so you have to figure out who the delegates are gonna be ahead of time. Like I described this process of these delegates being determined afterwards, but in some states, they're actually on the ballot. And, you know, Obama was not incredibly well known at that time, and we were trying to do this before he had won any elections, right? So we had to determine who all these people were gonna be earlier in 2007, before any elections had happened. And so we literally, like, for some, to fill some of our delegate spots, we were like going through lists of people who had donated to the campaign or who had volunteered for the campaign and calling them and just saying, hey, like, we saw you donated to the campaign, we need some delegates. Like, are you interested in being a delegate to the national convention? And then they would either say, you know, yes, or never, you know, don't ever call me again. And so, but those were examples. All those people who got put on, a lot of them were just like regular people who were excited about Obama for the first time and who had donated money. So that is another way to go. But typically you need to be somewhat active and in the state party and sort of be participating or be active with one of the campaigns and have the candidate pick you, you know, if it's one of the states where the candidate gets to decide. As with like basically any question you could ask me about the nomination process, it varies state by state. That's like the answer to everything. It varies state by state. That's right. I didn't want to out him, but if he would like to explain that. So we have some, there was someone in my class actually yesterday who is also interested in being a delegate for Americans abroad. So he will know more of the details about that than I will. Any other questions? Yes. I was thinking maybe we should do that. Do you think we can do the floating mic? Is that a better way to go?
James Brown, TUJ. Just wondering about running as an independent. Not me, I'm not gonna run as an independent, but if someone wanted to, what's the process for doing that?
That's a good question. So the requirements to get on the ballot varies from state to state. You'll be surprised that's my answer. No, but it's an important question this year because there's been a lot of speculation about one, like whether the Republican establishment might put up an independent candidate to combat Trump if he's the nominee, and then also, you know, might Trump run as an independent if he feels he is treated, I think he's used the phrase, treated unfairly. By the Republican establishment and by the convention. And so in most states, the requirements vary state to state, but in most states there's some process where if you can gather enough signatures or show that you're known, you can get on the ballot. And that process, I think the first states, it's sometime in May that the first states have the states with the earliest deadlines for that start to kick in. But that's only a couple states. It's more sort of later in the summer that you have a big tranche of states where if you have not submitted the signatures by that deadline, you cannot get on the ballot. But it does make the logistics of sort of competing in the convention and then running as a pure independent quite difficult. Like I'm not sure that that's actually even logistically possible. So the other possibility, and sorry, just to rewind on the independent front, it's very doable. If you like decide early enough that you want to run as an independent and you have some sort of operation, you know, you can do it. And we've had, you know, some relatively, I mean, no one who's won, but we've had some prominent people run as independents. And Michael Bloomberg this year was seriously considering it, and he would have had, you know, I'm sure he would have gotten on every every ballot across the country. So it's very doable if you decide and you organize enough ahead of time. But anyway, back to what might happen with the Republicans. Because of the logistical difficulties, like another thing that people are talking about is not running as an independent technically, but latching on to one of these smaller parties. So like the Republicans, I sort of went through this presentation pretending like the only two parties in America are the Republicans and the Democrats, because they are the dominant ones. And that's, they're obviously the most important. But there are these other smaller parties like the Green Party, the Libertarian Party, the Constitution Party. There's several others that actually get on the ballot for president every single year. So you could be voting for those people. So there's some question is one of those, like maybe would Trump be able to latch on to one of those, take advantage of the fact that they have already dealt with the ballot access issues and run as an independent that way?
Hi, my name is Paul Nutto. I work for the Japanese Diet. You mentioned the possibility that Paul Ryan or Mitt Romney may, I don't want to say usurp the convention, but get on the ballot at the convention. What would be the process for doing that? When would they have to get started building momentum, building an organization, something like that? So how would that work, basically?
Yeah, so I don't think there's much chance it'll be Mitt Romney. I think Paul Ryan is like the more realistic possibility, and there's lots of, it's hard to figure out what's sort of real and what's just the rumor mill of Washington, D.C., but the rumor mill is spinning about the potential of a Paul Ryan candidacy. My wife and I were debating, if we had to gamble on who would be the nominee, who would it be? And her choice is Paul Ryan. So if you want the Paul Ryan argument, you can go to her. But mechanically what would happen is, I think the first thing they'd have to do is they'd have to change that rule, which is rule 40, which again, there's this rule right now that says that you have to even qualify to be the nominee, you have to have won the majority of delegates in 8 states. So someone like Paul Ryan obviously cannot meet that and won't be able to meet that. So they would need to change that rule and get rid of it basically at the beginning of the convention or at some point during the convention. And then, I think it could happen a couple different ways. Like there could be a real effort to organize sort of heading into the convention, or it could happen a little bit more organically where, Trump doesn't get to 1237 on the first ballot, and then it moves to a second ballot, and still nobody gets it, and to a third ballot, and there's sort of a stalemate between the Trump and the Cruz people, and there's like a small number of holdouts that are refusing to go to either of them. And then momentum builds for a third candidate. That's one way it could happen. Or there could be a concerted effort by somebody to really reach out to all these delegates before the convention and say, hey, like if this gets to a second ballot or a third ballot, like please consider voting for person X. Now Ryan has said like all along he's not interested and that he's not pursuing this, but he did also say that about the speakership of the House. And so we know how that turned out. But I think does that answer your question? Like, I don't know if.
As much as it could be answered.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing I should say is, if this happens, right? Like, I think I mentioned that the last time we had a second ballot, I think was in the 1950s. I mean, this is like uncharted territory in modern presidential nominating, cycles. So, like, who knows, right? Like, no one's gone through this before. So if Paul Ryan decides he wants to be the nominee, right, they're gonna be like sort of trying to figure this out a little bit on the fly or looking at history much further back.
Toshio Sudo, businessman. I'm wondering how strict the process is controlled at the when you have primary at a very local basis. For example, non-supporters can become supporters of Democratic Party or Republic Party temporarily and participate the board, or some people of the opposition party pretend to be the opposition party and to participate the process to mix things up.
Right, so I mean in some states are what are called open, in which case you can't vote in both primaries, but you can decide which one you want to vote in. So sometimes you have these theories that like a group from one party are gonna vote in the other election to try to mess up the the results, but that's all within the rules in those states. I think your question was more about like the integrity of the process and whether there are problems ever in terms of, I think, you know, I don't think any election is run perfectly, any nationwide election in the US, so there's always gonna be some issues somewhere, but I think in terms of like actual voter fraud and, you know, corruption affecting the actual results, I think that's a very but I think that's a very small problem in general. So I think the Florida reference is a little different, which is there's often severe problems because of insufficient funding for like having the best voting machines possible. There's often problems with extremely long lines because there's not enough polling places open, and there's some disparities between economic class on who that tends to affect. There's lots of things like that that are problems with the voting system, but in terms of the kind of straight up fraud, I don't think that that's, you know, at least certainly relative to other countries, I don't think that that's a big problem in the US. That's my opinion, at least.
Thanks, Andre. You know, being from the state of Florida, we've actually butchered two elections, 2000 and 1876. We submitted two sets of electoral votes, to be counted in 1876, as you, I'm sure you well recall that. I just have a question, though, about really an opinion on your part. We talked a minute ago about all of the independent candidates that can run. I think in my state, I've seen 30 or 40 candidates on a general election from every kind of political party you can imagine. But what I am a little bit concerned about, and there is, as you said, there's no real set rule on this, is that let's say Trump gets within 200 or 100 or whatever delegates of winning the nomination. Do you see a a political turning point where he's denied the nomination and it could manifest itself into a violent outcome? And what number, this is an opinion, where do you think is the dividing line for when things would get out of hand?
I think there's a lot to be concerned about Trump's campaign in general. And I do think it's concerning the violence you've seen at some of his rallies in terms of how they've handled protesters. And I think, I think the tenor of his campaign sort of encourages that type of, or at least does not discourage that type of violent behavior, and I think that is concerning. And so when you have him saying, and I don't remember what the exact quote was, but when you have him saying things like, you know, that there's gonna be riots at the convention if they try to take this away from me or treat me unfairly, like that is definitely concerning. Now I have faith that that's not gonna happen. I don't know what I think if he gets, I don't know if he's 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 short, like I kind of tend to think he'll figure out a way to get above 1237. But I think if it's more than that, if it's more like 100 or 200, I think it's going to be a contested convention. And I think there's a very good chance it is going to be like 100 or 200 short.
Okay, so if you do think it's going to be a contested convention, what's the vetting process then for vice presidential? Because normally they know who's going to be going to the convention. It's not really a real vote. So then do all the candidates pick vice presidents ahead of time in case they win at the convention?
That's a good question. I mean, we would be in uncharted territory. So mechanically the convention also votes on who the vice presidential nominee is going to be. So, but as you said, over the last several decades, we've known ahead of time who the presidential and vice presidential nominee are going to be, and everyone just defers to whoever the president chooses. So I don't know, that'll be interesting to see. I mean, you can imagine if Trump is trying to portray himself as sort of like, I am the presumptive even though I'm short of 1237, I am the presumptive nominee. You could imagine him sort of making his announcement of who his vice presidential pick is, just as like part of this narrative of like, I'm gonna be the nominee and I'm the presumptive one. I don't know that anyone else would do that, but you know, anything is possible. But so I think most likely either you would have none of them sort of declaring who their person's gonna be, or you have Trump get out of the gate and announce his vice presidential candidate, and then, you know, some Cruz would have to decide whether to follow suit or just kind of let that slide. But yeah, I don't know.
So, all right, it's on. Marius Reitz from the German Embassy. I was wondering, with the Obama campaign in 2008, arguably being like the first one that was really set on social media, and with Trump seeing that again with Twitter, do you think that this is a shift away from the influence of super PACs? And do you think that's a positive thing or a negative thing, that we see more, you know, unorthodox campaigning and less influence of campaigning with big TV ads and radio shows and things that traditionally would involve more money and more, you know, traditional campaigning by or traditional funding by super PACs?
Right, so I think it's a mixed bag. So just for everyone else's benefit, if you don't know what a super PAC is, these are technically independent groups that are independent of the candidates who are under current law allowed to raise unlimited amounts of money and then spend that money on behalf of whatever campaigns they want. In reality, most of the super PACs are fairly closely associated, or very closely associated, with a particular campaign. And while they cannot formally coordinate, there are a huge number of loopholes to that prohibition, and a fair amount of what any of us would call coordination ends up actually happening. So these are this is where the sort of huge amount of unrestricted money flows into the political process, because the actual candidates, there are limits on how much I can donate to a particular candidate as an individual, but I can give, I wish I had $1 billion. If I did, I could give all of it away to a super PAC if I wanted to. So that's where a lot of the money is flowing in right now. So your question, I think, you know, just on the super PACs, I think their influence is definitely a bad development for democracy, and I'm definitely in the camp that was very disappointed that the Supreme Court struck down the restrictions on the spending of their money. So I think that's bad. I haven't really thought about like the connection between that and the social media, right? Like, I think on the positive side of social media, it's a good way for candidates to connect directly with the voters. And I do think that that's good in general, right? Like, it's important to have the media reporting on this and identifying things that candidates are saying that are true or false, but it's also a good way for candidates just to connect with people directly. And you're right that the Obama campaign did an incredible job of that. I think with Trump, we see the sort of negative side of it, right? Like, with just last week, I'm sure many of you saw this, right? He retweeted a picture, like a unflattering picture of Ted Cruz's wife next to a flattering picture of his wife, which was, just a disappointing move in terms of the tenor of the presidential campaign. And there are a number of things that he has said that are just on Twitter or elsewhere that are offensive and disappointing. I think if you care about, a good political process and debate. So I think it's a mixed bag, you know. I don't know. I think used wisely, it's a positive thing, and used unwisely, it's a very negative thing. And before this capability, you know, we probably wouldn't have had, Trump probably would not be as successful as he is. As you can tell, I'm not a fan of Trump.
Hi, Alex Howard, TUJ. You've given a great overview of the details of the process, but I'm curious, if we took a sort of longer view or stood back a little, you know, what kinds of politicians are rewarded by this process that you've described? What skills are rewarded? Particularly from a comparative perspective, and if this is such an unusual election, has anything changed institutionally? It seems to me nothing has changed institutionally. So maybe the institutions don't matter, in a way. So I don't know if you can speak to that just a little. I mean, obviously you need a good lawyer to get through the process, right? But beyond that, what's being rewarded by this process that might not be in a different system?
Right. So I think. I mean, there's a couple of different ways, I think, to approach that question. I mean, so one question is, you know, what does campaigning in general in America, what does that reward? And, you know, I think it rewards what you think it would reward. It rewards people who are good on their feet, well-spoken, who can inspire people, who are entertaining, and can command an audience. It also rewards people who can raise a lot of money. That's in general. In terms of like the specific process with this nomination process, I think there's kind of two points I would make. First, it's important to remember who is voting in these elections. So, you know, I think I said about 40% of Americans consider themselves independents. Roughly, it's a little bit less than this, like roughly 30% consider themselves Democrats, and I think just a little bit under that consider themselves Republicans, okay? So for the most part, the only people participating in the Republican process is this slice of somewhere between 25 and 30% of Americans, okay? They're the only ones even eligible to participate for the most part. Of that group, a pretty small percentage of them actually vote in the primary process, okay? So Iowa, which was the most important caucus, and sorry, I'm going off on a little bit of a tangent here because I meant to cover this earlier and I didn't. Iowa, which is the most important caucus, had about 15, if you combine the Democratic and Republican caucuses, had about 15 or 16% of the eligible adult voting population participating. So that's a very small percentage. In the primaries, it runs usually somewhere between about 20% and 35 or 40%, also quite small. I think New Hampshire had the highest participation for a primary, and it was just over 50%. So on the Republican side, you have this slice of less than 30% of the eligible adult voters in America. Of that 30%, a fairly small percentage are actually voting. And of those that have voted, only about 37% have voted for Trump. Okay, so it's just like, it's, you know, what he has done has surprised everybody, and no political pundit predicted this, but it's, and so he should not be underestimated, but at the same time, it's just important to remember that this is a very small slice of America that is actually voting for him, okay? So, and on the Democratic side, you know, this is just as true. It's just as true on the Democratic side that it's a small slice of the Democratic Party that's voting. So to your point, the first point I wanted to make is that this particular process, it favors people who are successful at appealing to kind of the extremes, or the ends of the spectrum at least, of the American political electorate, because most of the people in the middle who are independents are not participating in this process. And then even within the Democratic Party, within the Republican Party, you know, usually the people who hold the strongest, most resolute views are the ones that are, or often are the ones that are, you know, kind of fired up enough to get out there and vote. So that's kind of one point. And the second point, and I think this is where you're going to see this play out a little bit more over the next couple of months. It can, in a close election, favor someone who is better at playing kind of the inside party game and who is more organized on that front. And right now it appears that Cruz is more organized on that front than Trump is, at least according to media reports, right? So there is this, you know, all these things happening in the states with these state party meetings and committees meeting to pick the actual delegates, and there's, you know, all this stuff happening on the ground to figure out who those people are. And sort of planning for that and strategizing for that and then executing it successfully is going to be rewarded this year, and it seems like it'll reward Cruz. I should say in 2008, you know, which I'm more familiar with, I don't remember what the exact numbers were, but it was a somewhat similar situation, just reversed, where Obama had not like a, you know, crazy lead in terms of the numbers, but a healthy lead on the delegate front, and the math just made it very difficult for Clinton to catch up. But the way he built that lead was largely on the backs of the caucus states. He dominated Clinton in the caucus states, and that was partly like very smart strategy. Like the campaign staff looked at the map, they realized that his supporters were enthusiastic and that he could get out the vote in these caucus states, and that was where they could build a lead and build a gap, and that's what happened. And so that sort of forward thinking is maybe and kind of combined with inside game is rewarded as well, in a way that is, you know, perhaps less true in other elections in America and other elections in other countries. One more point on Trump, just really quickly, just to hammer home this point on the view. They asked this question on whether, you know, do you have a favorable opinion of Trump or do you have an unfavorable opinion of Trump? Do you have a favorable opinion of Hillary Clinton? Do you have an unfavorable opinion? Okay. And Trump right now, a number of different organizations ask this question, but if you average them out, his unfavorable rating, this is the American public in general, is somewhere between 60 and 65%. Okay, that is like that's a large number, you know? You might be disturbed that even 30% or whatever it is have a favorable opinion. That might bother you, but it's important to remember that most of America has an unfavorable opinion of Trump. And I should say Clinton also has, overall it's more unfavorable than favorable, but she is more in the 14, 15, I think the worst one has her at negative 20. In terms of negativity. Both of those are actually, this was my final slide. This shows you all the elections going back to 1984, and this poll was asked at this point in each election cycle. But you can see that Clinton, and this is, again, this is the worst of all the polls, this is the worst one. She's on most polls more like here somewhere. But you can see she's like very, very low by comparison to other candidates. But then Trump is all the way down here in the 30s. So this is, this is interesting and telling, I think. So this is just yet another point about that the folks voting for Trump are quite a relatively small slice of the electorate. How's that rate for that's a good question. I don't know. I'm guessing he's like here somewhere, but I would have to look that up.
Jeffrey Gilbert, I work in the pharmaceutical industry. Turning to the Democratic primary process for a moment, it appears increasingly apparent that Sanders will have the wherewithal to remain in the process for what will be for Clinton an uncomfortably long period of time. And I'm curious to hear your views on what that will culminate in. Will he be satisfied with influencing the convention platform? Or, for example, as a candidate who's technically an independent already, could you imagine him running as an independent in the general election? Thank you.
I don't think he'll run as an independent. I think he decided to participate in this process. And I would have to double check this. I believe he's said things to this effect that he will not run as an independent. But look, I think it's very unlikely that he catches up to her, but he's, you know, it's not mathematically impossible, and he has every right to stay in this race as long as he wants to. So I think there's a very good chance that he will stay in it till the end of the primaries in June or until shortly before that. Maybe he'll, you know, drop out earlier. I can't speak to what his motivation is at the moment, but I'm guessing his motivation is that he still thinks he has a chance to win, and that's why he's in it. And that, you know, as a backup move, you're right. I mean, he's bringing a lot of attention to issues that are important to him and that are important to a lot of members of the Democratic Party. But my guess would be that he's, you know, still in it, thinking that he has a chance to to win this thing. There was an article a couple of days ago, I think it was in the New York Times, about sort of some regret on the behalf of like either his or his top staff that he hadn't more aggressively attacked Clinton earlier in the campaign season on a number of issues, because that, you know, I think the sense is had he done that, then maybe this gap would not be so big. But certainly in terms of what they're saying publicly, you know, he's still in it to win the thing.
Hi, Christian Walker. I work in electronics. I'm wondering about the future, what the results of this or the process of this election might have on future elections. Two of the top four candidates are deeply unfavorable, according to the chart you just showed, and two more are not born and bred members of their parties. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are for future implications.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, one thing I'll say is that, you know, they tinker with the rules for these nominating processes every 4 years, and often the rule changes reflect something about the previous cycle that people did not like that they want to try to fix for the next time around. So, in fact, some of these tweaks that the Republicans made a few years ago, I think, were designed to try to make it easier for the front runner to secure the nomination, so that the, because there was a view that the previous time it took Romney too long to secure the nomination and it damaged him for the general election. And it's sort of, you know, ironic now that the, you know, they're desperately, the establishment is desperately trying to prevent the front runner from securing the nomination. So I'm sure they will come up with other changes. So there's that which will happen. Like there will be, you know, the party leaders will get together and try to think of other ways to design the process in a way that fits their desires better. So that's on one level. And then I think, you know, it's hard to know, like there is, you know, tremendous frustration across the country with Washington, D.C., with the political establishment in Washington, in D.C. and in Congress. And the country is very divided. And I think you see a lot of that playing out, right? I think like part of why Trump has done so well, and even Cruz, who is a senator, but who is sort of basically on his own in the Senate and is running an anti-DC campaign also. And Sanders is sort of also, again, he's in the Senate, but he's considered a bit of an outsider. You know, I think part of their success is that there's deep, deep frustration with the political process and system. So I am not that optimistic that this is going to lead to Congress and the White House working better together, or to Republicans and Democrats working together better. Like I just, I don't know. I hope that would result from this, but I'm not sure that it will. So I don't know. It'll be interesting to see. You know, there's a lot of, after the last election, there were a lot of Republicans saying, okay, this is the wake up call. You know, the demographics of the country are changing. We need to have a bigger tent where we are bringing in more, you know, non-white people into the Republican Party, because there are all these, you know, various states that where the demographics were changing and are just kind of more consistently going Democratic now. And, you know, I remember I was at the White House at the time, and there was a real feeling that, like, okay, this is the moment. Like, we're going to get immigration reform done now, because there is just so much political pressure on the Republicans to not turn off the communities that care about that in America, because they just got destroyed in the election, in part because those communities voted Democratic. And that just like kind of didn't happen, right? Like immigration reform failed, and now we have, you know, Trump and Cruz at the top. So I don't know. So my optimism is not that high at the moment. Yeah, you'll have to ask somebody smarter than me, like what actually will happen, you know, in the years after this as a result of this election cycle.
My name is Kurt Sieber, Austrian Business Council. I have two questions. The first one, to what extent can delegates change their pledges in the process, and when is that possible? And the second question is, that's from far away here in Japan. the feeling is that there is a an uneven balance on more personal attacks than really decide the election on policies. What could you comment on that?
Sure, thank you. I'm gonna take your second question first. And I think on that, we have a very different story on the Republican side than the Democratic side this year. And I don't think that's because, I don't think this is only because I'm a Democrat and I'm biased. So on the Republican side, I agree with you. I think it's been, it's been a low level of discourse and has been disappointing the tenor of the campaign and has not focused on substantive policy in a real way. On the Democratic side, I think the Democratic side is sort of more typical of what we're used to. You know, I think that Clinton and Sanders have had a healthy debate. I think it has been more substantive and policy oriented, but you know, personality plays an important part as well, because on a number of issues, they are not that far apart on the substance. But I think that analysis, what you said, is certainly true of the Republican primary this year. So hopefully the general election, whoever it is, the tenor of the discussion and debate will be a bit better. And in terms of your first question on when the delegates can change their votes, so again, there's on the Republican side, on the Democratic side, you have these superdelegates who are free to change whenever they want. And there's a small number of unpledged delegates on the Republican side that can do the same. But for most, this is largely driven by either state law or state party rules. Most of the delegates, basically 90 to 95% of them, have to vote for the person that they are associated with on the first ballot, right? So if whoever you actually like, if you were a delegate that was allotted to Trump, you have to vote for him on the first ballot. But after the first ballot, about a little bit more than 50% of the delegates get freed based on their state rules. They are then free to vote for whoever they want after the first ballot. So beginning on the second ballot, more than 50% can vote for whoever they want. And then a number of states, they force you to vote for the person on the first two ballots, but you're free on the third ballot to vote for whoever you want. And at that point, it's about 80-some percent are free beginning on the third ballot to vote for whoever they want. And then there is a handful of states where you are you have to just vote for your candidate until the candidate releases you or tells you. So some states bind you sort of throughout the process. There might be some that on the third or fourth ballot switch over, I'm not sure. But basically after the first and or second ballot, most of them are gonna be free to vote for whoever they choose.
Hi, my name is Ken Kosone. I'm a Japanese government official. And my question is that do you think that Mr. Trump will run as the independent if he's not nominated as the Republican convention? And the second question is that you mentioned that the support of the Mr. Trump is very slight number of the people. So you think that the Trump phenomenon is just the one-shot things that happen in this election, or is just changing the American politics or society?
So on your the second question on the Trump phenomenon, I think part of this is part of this is that Trump himself is a very big personality and sort of figure in the American psyche, and had this popular reality TV show and these books about business, and obviously has a lot of bravado and is a very entertaining figure. And so I can't really think of that many other people that are like Trump. So I do think there's something about the individual that is driving this. But I also think that there has been an opening created by how dysfunctional the American government has been in terms of actually moving issues forward on a bipartisan basis. And certainly that's the perception of Americans as well. And I think as long as that continues, it leaves the door open for someone who's an outsider, who is just, you know, willing to speak off the cuff and who's very entertaining. So I do think you could have more of that if sort of the, you know, the tenor doesn't change in Washington, D.C. And will you remind me what your first question was? Oh, as an independent, right. So I think, I just pulled this up actually, I had the deadlines here for running as an independent, right? So there are these logistical difficulties of getting on the ballot in all these states. And a number of states, by the time July rolls around, there's a number of states where you have to have submitted the, you know, petition signatures to get on the ballot. So I do think that if he is denied at the convention and if he thinks he should have gotten the nomination and that he was, you know, treated unfairly, I do think he'll try to figure out a way potentially to run. I could see that. Or he will demand something else from the Republican Party. But I think logistically probably the route is to try to latch on to one of these much smaller parties that exists who are already on the ballot in these states. And I don't know enough about the details of each of them to know whether they would be open to a Trump candidacy or not.
I have a question. When Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton are elected as Republican candidates, and are there any possibilities that Democrats vote for Trump and Republicans vote for Hillary Clinton?
I think the answer to both those questions is yes. However, so, okay, so if you are arguing that Trump might actually win the election against Hillary Clinton, so if you assume this is sort of the basic map going into the general election, you'll see that the Democrats actually already start out with a little bit of a advantage here with these ones that are sort of leaning Democratic or safely Democratic, 247, Republicans, 206, okay? So there's a little bit of an advantage. So the argument for Trump goes that his most popular base is working class white voters, in particular white males. And some people have said, okay, well, there's quite a few of those in what's called the Rust Belt, sort of these states here, so that maybe, you know, Trump could win Ohio, maybe even Pennsylvania becomes close, or Wisconsin, even maybe Minnesota. So that's the argument for Trump. The problem is that I don't think there's much polling that backs that up, at least at the moment, and I think it's just as likely that he turns off so many voters that a bunch of these states become easier for the Democrats to win. But there's some discussion and some debate about whether any of these white working class voters who are in the Democratic Party might support Trump. And it's just, I would say it's a bit unclear at the moment. I think some people would argue yes, but there's some good evidence that that wouldn't happen. On the flip side, I think I think it's likely that a number of Republicans would not want to vote for Trump. And then there's two possibilities. One is that they go vote for Clinton, or I guess there's three possibilities. They vote for Clinton, they go vote for some other candidate, or they just don't vote, okay? And that's possible too. And, you know, there's, that's certainly true of like sort of people in the establishment. You know, there was a number of foreign policy luminaries on the Republican side who said that they just like could not stand having Trump as president, and they would never support him as the president. So you have people out there who are publicly saying this. I mean, this is unprecedented in recent history too, having all these prominent figures saying that they would refuse to support the person who's potentially gonna be the nominee of their party. And so I do think there's a real chance that could happen. And there's one important point that I wanna make, which is that Republicans in the establishment are very nervous about Trump being the nominee, because it's not just about, yes, the presidency is the most important election, but in the US on that election day in November, one third of the Senate is also up for election, and every single member of the House of Representatives is up for election. And usually in those years, the presidential race is kind of the driving force between whether people show up to vote or not. So if a lot of Republicans are frustrated with Trump and they don't want to support Clinton and they just end up sitting at home and they don't vote, well, that also means they're not voting for their senator, for Republican, and their Republican member of the House. And so there's nervousness with the Republicans that they will not only lose the presidency, but that they will lose a number of Senate seats and a number of seats in the House of Representatives. So, and this has kind of come, this has come up a little bit in the Supreme Court discussion. As you may know, we have a vacancy on the Supreme Court, and President Obama has nominated Judge Garland, and the Republicans are refusing to have hearings or to vote on him. But there is some chance that they will lose the presidency, lose the Senate, and then have, you know, even a more progressive nominee if Clinton ends up being president after November. So there is concern in Republican circles about Trump, not just because of the presidency, but because of all these other elections that are happening on the same day.
Well, thank you very much, Andre. This was perfect. And we can't offer you an honorarium because, as you know, we get the Ministry of Education doesn't want to support us, so we have no money. So we can give you another bottle of water. Here it is. And of course, if our honored guests make contributions to the donation boxes, next time we'll be able to offer a bottle of orange juice to Nancy when she speaks about Donald Trump. So thanks again. Thank you all for coming. And thank you very much, Andrei.